Well, folks, we've encountered a little bit of a snag today, literal, while we're fishing. The cows are being worked out there, as you can hear in the distance. It's the sound of a dog barking, and he's chasing cows around and pushing them this way and pushing them that way. So I have to wait. The road's blocked by a couple trucks. We're at the actual house of the people who live here. You can see there's a anhinga or a cormorant just went dove out there, which means there's fish here. So we're gonna go ahead and take a few casts, show you what I'm fishing with. Let me see where my camera's pointing. I'm fishing with a one of these. I don't see a name on it. This one looks like an actual old one. This one might be from the 60s. It's an old Meps spoon or a different type of spoon. There's an anhinga right there. You see that hooked bill he's got. If the bill's long with a little bit of yellow, it's probably an anhinga. If it's shorter, it's going to be a cormorant probably. Both very similar birds. They both eat everything in here. They will eat all the fish if you let them. I don't have to worry too much. He won't go after my lure. But of course, I don't know what's out. I've never fished this water before. This is their personal front lawn pond here. pretty nice, huh? Pretty snazzy. I saw the water bulge a little bit. There could have been something chasing it. Don't really know, but try over there a little bit closer to that tree. Really, when I hit an area like this that I've never fished before, I'm just going to fan cast closer to the surface because I don't know what kind of snags are down deep. And I don't want to lose my lure on the first cast, of course. And this is a spinner. You just go straight with this lure. You don't have to do any kind of jigging or any kind of motion and thing weird. You just got to kind of just move it along slowly. It looks like it has a lot of action already. You can actually bring it right below the surface of the water. Oop, there's a fish. To create kind of a wake in the water. And that will, fish can see that from a distance. They can really see it. So I'm going to get out from under this tree so I can actually cast a little bit. So far, not even a strike here. But that doesn't mean there's no fish. It just means that I may not want this thing. You see how it puts out that little bit of a surface wake right there? That really does a number on fish. They see that from a distance. That's a anhinga out there. Really kind of a cool bird. So I'm not getting even a strike here. I'm just kind of concerned about that. It could be this lure. Could be that cows don't want me to catch fish. They told the fish don't eat. So we're gonna try the entire pond here. I got the wind to my back, so you should all be okay. Got a hat on top of my head so that I cut down some of the glare or whatever, and also some of the wind noise. And so I'm trying to just work every possible angle of this, and I'm gonna bring myself closer to the shoreline here. I want to work the shoreline instead of working. Hi, hello, Mr. Anhinga. There she is, or he is, or it is. They will dive great distances and get themselves a nice meal of fish. Probably why there aren't many fish in here. Mrs. Anhinga there has eaten them all. Cast over here since she's over there. See, she's over there. Right where I was casting, of course. It's a big lake, so there's a, you know, I mean, considering it's a small lake, but it's big considering when you want to pinpoint where fish are going to be. They could be anywhere because there could be all kinds of structure here. There could be a sunken thing out in the middle or whatever. And so with that in mind, you have to consider that the fish might not be in the normal spots you would look, like in a shoreline where there's reeds and stuff. You'd imagine you'd find fish. They could be out in the center where there's a giant sunken tree. Now, when you build a lake like this, normally you would put structure, like sunken things, in the lake. And by doing that, you give places for fish to live. But that anhinga probably has eaten everything in here. Most likely he's eaten most of the fish in this thing. There's fish in here, I know there are, but I'm sure anhinga did a number on them. So I'm just gonna basically just work this She's right there under the water. See if she's gonna pop up in about a second. Wish those cows would hurry up. Probably gators in here too. I'm gonna try to keep this on the surface to give it a nice, so all you do to get it on the surface is keep your rod tip up high so you get that wake. Yeah, and there's kind of a fine line between too fast and too slow, and you get a nice bulge in the water like that. And that really does attract fish from a distance. They can see that from deep because it cuts the glare from the sky on the surface. I think the anhinger's right there. See, when I see little bubbles and stuff, I'm trying to find I don't want to cast on her. You know, anhinger, couldn't you pick another spot in this entire ranch to go fish? Right here, while I come and fish, you have to come and get in my way. Where are you, sweets? Where'd she go? I see some action right there, I don't know. The blip, like little things in the water. I'm hoping we can get out to the stream today. I do hope this is not my fate for the day here. See how I have that going right at the surface like that? Yeah. Nothing's even going near it. Let's take a little jaunt around here and see. Okay. Trying this side right here. I think I saw the anhinga pop up over there. I see it right there. That's the kind of drag I got on there. Tighten that a little bit. Oh, do I have a fish? Hey! First one of the day. It's a crappie. I'll be a son of a gun to have crappie in here. Wow, they must have stocked this thing with crappie. Hold on. See, now these hooks have no barbs, so they come right off. If I could figure out which way that little hook is going. Oops. All right, folks. Honestly, wouldn't believe it if I didn't see it myself, but that to me looks like a crappie. I mean, I don't know. Honestly, I don't know what that is. Right now, off the top of my head, I don't have the slightest clue as to what that fish is. I would say crappie by the coloration. Honestly, don't know what that is. I'm gonna go home and I'm gonna identify this fish for you. Folks, hey, I caught one right here. I've never caught one of these before. I don't think I have. Let's get a good ID on it so I can really take it home and look. The spiny and dorsal soft rays are together right there. It could be a crappie. I don't wanna keep them out too long. Put them back. I don't know what that was. I'm really happy I caught it. Crappie, usually we don't have in Florida crappie. So that's why I'm just kind of wondering what that was, but of course they could have stocked this with crappie. That's very possible. Strange. That is a first for me. That's another species on the list that I've never caught before. Hey, you saw it here. Yeah, we're recording. You saw it here first. Sorry for not having two cameras again, folks. I am I damaged the ribbon wires on my other camera. You camera junkies will know what that's about, or electronics people will know about that. I damaged the wire, so now I am stricken to one camera, which I'm really not that upset about because it's less work for me, obviously. I don't have to, it's a little bit less work. Not actually, you want to know something? It became double the amount of editing I did because I really had a lot more fun editing just the one camera rather than having the two cameras to split screen and not pay as much attention to. So it was nice to be able to pay attention on my last video with just one camera's footage. Anyway, I do know there's fish in here though, so that's a good thing. I don't know what that was. I'm going to say it was a crappie. off the top of my head from what it looked like, but I don't know. Never caught it before in my life. First time. New species on the list, folks. New species. That's pretty cool. So, hey, you know, this was actually a blessing in disguise because I got to catch a new species. And by the markings, honestly, I say that was a crappie. I've never seen it with a fish with that kind of mouth structure and weird, very weird little bugger that was. For me. I mean, somebody else might catch those all the time, but I've never caught one here in Florida. And I've caught hundreds of different, couple hundred species. You know, I don't know how many species I've caught. I've caught like so many different types of fish. Just little fish, big fish, whatever fish. But that little guy, he ate that thing. So this thing's obviously an appealing meal to somebody. It's lure. Found these lures in a tackle box that was marked for trash. Someone didn't sell it in a garage sale. They have lots of garage sales here. And if something doesn't sell, they just put it out to the side of the road for the next day for trash. And I got there quicker than the trash man could and took the... and grabbed it and got myself a bunch of these Roadrunner lures, which are, you know, like 1960s. I think they were invented, these Roadrunner styles. I don't sell them. Oh, there's a fish. I'm not trying to influence you to buy them, but I do have such good luck on them. And I think from now on, I'm a fan. Personally, I'm a fan now. There's a fish here, so we're going to stay over here. I'm a fan of these. I will go and purchase these myself if I have to. Luckily, I've managed to keep the ones that I have, about six of them, intact. The hooks are all breaking off, but I can always put a new hook on there. Very simple, just a little piece of wire or piece of heavy line and loop it on there, snap swivel or something. It'll be easily done. But I'm not, this spinner, the body of this lure is absolutely phenomenal. There, I have not yet had such a versatile lure for doing so little with it, just moving it through a water column and having fish strike at it as if it was the only thing they've ever seen, like the best food in the world. And it's just a hunk of metal. I wish I could get over there, but all right, I'm glad I got to catch that thing, whatever that was. we'll call it a crappie for now. I'm gonna bounce it a little bit since nothing's taking it on the straight retrieve. A couple little bounces here and there just to kind of give it a little more action. A little bit of a different flutter. I'm gonna try to slow my retrieve a little bit. Keep the rod tip up because you don't know what kind of stuff's on the bottom. But bump the bottom a little bit with it. It's okay. As long as you don't get it hung up. And if you just bump the bottom, then you'll possibly trigger a strike out of a fish. You're also going to get some weeds once in a while. But the front of that lure, when it bumps into stuff, will trigger a strike on a fish. But, you know, if that, there were barbs, that would be in my shirt forever. But all I have to do is give it a little tug and it's out. Take barbs off the hook, folks. If you're not keeping the fish, it's so much easier. It's so much easier. And it's nicer, it's easier on the fish too. The fish doesn't have to have that. If you ever had a hook in your finger, you know that the barb is the worst part of the whole thing, pulling it back out. And you know, same for the fish. I mean, fish don't have pain receptors like humans do, like mammals do, you know, so it's a different thing for them. But at the same time, rather than damage the actual fish itself, you know, you don't have to damage it as much. It's kind of nice to not be so abrupt in nature, isn't it? You know, once in a while, we don't have to be so much of an earthquake. I wish they'd hurry up out there. I don't know what's happening. I might have to change this lure up. I don't see anything else happening here. I got that window to consider with the belly of the line, and to keep constant pressure on it against the belly of the wind, you have to sometimes retrieve a little heavier, and you have to angle the rod into the wind like this, so that the there's actual contact. You see the tip is a little bit bent. There's contact between you and the lure. You don't want that lure to flutter not the way it was designed to. I don't want to say naturally, because there's nothing natural about a piece of metal that flashes, but that doesn't really seem too natural. But in respect for the lure, if you do it by the way the lure is supposed to be swimming, by the way they designed it, then you're going to be successful, because they designed it with that in mind. Taking into consideration the way I just cast, I wanted to explain something to you, but I was talking about that. Get me out of the wind here a little bit. Wind is blowing. So folks, what we're talking about here, because the wind is too strong, is that when the wind is at your back like that and you're using the angle of it to get your cast out there, you have, like, I have no choice. I can't cast on the left because I'll be casting in the grass. So the idea is that if I want to get my lure along this shoreline, which is good, I'm going to use the wind to my advantage. And I'm going to use it like a golf swing, or if you've ever thrown a frisbee in the air and watched it come back to you like a boomerang. The idea is that you use the wind to your advantage, and I'm trying to cast into this shoreline over here where I can get, you know, there's structures on the shoreline that are something like, you know, sticks or holes. A lot of fish will bed down on the shoreline and leave holes behind. They actually dig holes with their tails, and that will create nice little structure pots. Also, there's different types of plant life because the light is allowed to penetrate the surface. So you'll have different types of water plants there, like water lilies. These all add to different structure on a shoreline, which is why you want to fish a shoreline. But also the idea that I'm trying to impart to you here is that, and while I'm just talking out there, is that you want to stop the line prior to the lure entering the water. Now, why is that? Well, generally in a cast, there's going to be an arc of the cast. So the lure is, you know, going up like a rainbow. And now as that lure is going like a rainbow, the line's peeling off your reel. And that wind might be stronger than the direction that you've cast the lure. And then the line itself is perpendicular to that. And so the wind is actually grabbing the line like a kite and shooting it off your reel. And you end up with what you call a real mess. And it's going to get tangled up around your shoes, around those plants on the bank. So the best tip I can give you on a windy day is use the wind at your disposal. You know, don't pack up and go home, because wind is good for fishing. First of all, that ripple on the surface is going to hide you. The fish aren't going to see you as well. Clear water conditions, the fish will always see you. And that edge that I'm fishing right there, that runs where the wind is directly running straight into it, that's going to be a push area where there's going to be a lot of debris pushed up there. Grasses, all kinds of detritus, which is, you know, stuff on the bottom that's decomposing. All of that and rocks and things with the current, a slight current from the fetch or catch on the surface there where the wind catches, that little bit of current, because this is not a body of water that has natural current in it, so that wind will create a current underneath that will turn up the bottom and get fish feeding and stuff on the stuff that gets turned up. It rolls rocks across the bottom, and that itself will actually kick up, you know, small crustaceans and things for fish to eat. So all those things you take into play, it's a big ballet happening in a small pond or even a large pond. Anywhere in the water, there's always a ballet of things happening. But the point I'm trying to make is if you follow the conditions, you can make the best of any situation. So when you're fishing wind like this, what I'm going to be doing here is trying to work this tree. See how, and you can see that the tree is very difficult for me to cast under with this lure. It's not made for this kind of condition. Well, at least I wasn't able to utilize it to my best for that kind of condition underneath that tree. I would use something like a flipping lure that you can hook weedless. This lure has got a huge treble hook on there. Of course, it was barbless. Still, treble hook gets caught on everything, anything and everything. I don't really like using treble hooks, but these lures, that's what they come with. Generally, they rust off anyway because they're made of bronze, which I like. I don't like to have stainless steel. It gets stuck in a fish and you never come out. Bronze will just rust out in a couple days. You leave bronze hooks out in the water, you'll see they disappear. They turn to dust. Which is good for the environment, basically, they decompose. But under that tree is a great spot. Fish will hide from the hunting birds under there. Monkeys might be there. You might find some monkeys, depending on where you live. And then basically that little area back there is the end of the pond.
And a lot of things will go in there to get out of the current, maybe to hide out from any kind of activity out there. The smaller fish might hide from the bigger fish. The anhinga might be chasing all the fish. But this is like a little last resort right in there. We tried it. Didn't really get any success in there. Normally, on a different day, I'm going to try it again to see if maybe the weather was just, the foul weather was just pushing the fish down. Because low pressure will make fish react. They're mostly water, so they're really tuned to pressure in the environment. So that's one of the things you should keep in mind. Anyway, we're going to be back to, I think, walking on the other side where the wind is less and I do catch some more fish. So thanks for joining me on this episode, and at least maybe you get some tips out of this, what to do, what not to do, and you get some scenery. It's something else to do, you know, and to learn about. Because like I said, we're only experts in what we do personally. You can't be experts in someone else's field, right? I mean, unless you start doing it and then become an expert in it. So keep that in mind. Have a good day, and thanks, tight lines to you. Thanks for all the support in the channel.
There's some action out there. I see some fish moving, but, you know, I don't know. This seems a pretty sparse lake. Or the fish are just smart in here. They don't want to eat this thing. It's possible, you know. These fish might have learned. They might have fished the heck out of these things, and these fish know what not to eat and stuff. But as it stands right now, I saw cattle moving down the road, which means that they're going back to their pens and stuff. But other than that, I don't know what we're gonna do in terms of. Terms of getting out to the main stream out there, it's kind of really irking me right now. I don't want to be here fishing at the house. I want to be out there on the ranch, and that's what this show is all about, is some good fishing, you know. And this isn't really good fishing right here at all. Don't underestimate your bad casts, you never know. There's nobody home here, not a single thing. It's just a little crappie, that's about it. Try a quicker retrieve. Maybe that'll, you know, entice them, a little stop and go. Like that, a little flutter. Nothing, not even a bite. I see something popping up over there. I don't know what it is. Yeah, I don't understand this. I'm not even getting a chase or anything. Nothing. Nothing. Well, we might be able to get out there in a couple minutes here. I'm seeing the road clear of cattle, so might be a good thing. When the road's got cattle on it, and it's a traffic jam in the half. You would think something would come after that, but there's no fish in there. So I'm gonna say that cormorant has eaten literally every fish in this pond, with an exception of a few that can hide well. But anything that would be normally out swimming around, and if there's no structure here, a sitting duck, they can't escape that the anhingas and cormorants, because remember there's a lot of anhingas and cormorants. Excuse me, they're spraying the skies today, folks, really bad. They gassed us. Anyway, try to catch some fish here. Really rough, a rough fishery right here. I think I'm hitting and bottom right there. Pretty bad, actually. Oh, I had a fish, actually. I don't know what that was. I'm thinking I might need to put a smaller lure on here. These flowers are pretty stuff. Man, trying, folks. I really try to get you fish here. Try to get you out on that field, out there in the woods fishing. You can hear the cattle over there being worked though. So I'm gonna go change the size. Can't even get a good cast on this, but then again, these fish aren't that far off the shoreline. If that's, you know, if there's gonna be some fish, there might be along the shoreline. So, unfortunately, this lure is very light for this rod, you know, it's just impossible to cast it. I'll be honest with you though, if I don't get a couple, any swipes, I'm just gonna quit this whole thing right here because I'm realizing that there's no fish. So. You try a couple things. You change the color of your lures up, change the size of your lure up. If you don't get any more bites, there's no fish there. Or they're just not the right fish that you're gonna be catching. Let's just put it that way. They're not for you, or for me, for us, or for somebody else. But the point is sometimes you're not gonna catch fish in a place, even if there are fish there. It just depends on the day as well. You know, it depends on the weather, it depends on a lot of conditions, variables. Always changing and always different. But if I don't get a rise from this thing, even from a bluegill, the bluegill is the most prolific fish. So if that thing is not out here, and this, if I'm not getting it on the first or second strikes, I'm kind of just running out of patience as to, oop, there we go, okay. So there are fish here. That's the first sign. We got a little bluegill that time. Look at the size of this little turd here. Little guy is so small. And these hooks again have no barb. And of course you can see that those fin structures on there, not like that, not like the other. Come here, little bucker. Although he looks just like that other fish, but that other fish had more of a crappie thing going on. Different fish though. Put you back, get bigger. I hear that truck moving, that's a good sign. So it seems that they're a little bit further offshore. So I just gotta try to get this cast out there a little bit. There might be some sunken structure right where I just caught that one. And so that's why I'll cast in the same spot. Bluegill will congregate in schools. Oh, hey, okay, some fish in here. We just needed to make the lure smaller, that's all. Couple little pops in there. Jig it around a little bit. So at least there's some little guys here, something to keep us busy until we get that road cleared. As the line gets a little bit more wet and it's more supple as you cast, you'll be able to cast further. And then as you wind it on tighter, of course, you'll be able to cast even more distance as the line gets neater spooled. Let's try on the other side. Let's try on this side of the cypress. At least to get the wind to my back, it helps a little bit. I'm just slowly retrieving this, maybe vary it a little bit every once in a while, give it a little pop, nothing major. This reel has seen many better days. This outfit is really earmarked for, I think somebody's after it. Nope, nobody. Something's stuck in this, in the reel here. Just double check. I think there's a piece of grass or something buried in there. Just take a look every once in a while. Double check you. Make sure everything's running smoothly or else you're going to be in trouble later. Oh, nothing's in there. Just don't know. Maybe the reel itself is bent. That's a possibility. Oh, folks, I really, really was hoping to get out there and not be fishing here in the backyard or the front yard of these people's house. I have a feeling now we could get out there. I'm going to take a couple more casts here just to satisfy my mind with this new lure. And it just doesn't seem anything's here. A couple bluegill, maybe a crappie, but that's really maybe some plecos and stuff like that. It's pretty bad though. Something just rose right here. Who knows? We'll give it a try. Might be something. You never know. Probably a gar, it could be a pleco. If there was a gar, he'd be after that. He'd see it, or she'd see it, or it would see it. Gar. Oh my guard. Oh my gar. Yeah, nobody wants this. I'm going to call it on this last cast here. We'll walk around the stream one more time here, and then we're going to go try and see if we can't get out to the field, because I got a spot I have to try. Keep that one to my back so you don't have to deal with it, and I could cast further, which is nice. Try to let it sink a little bit. You want to get it down a little bit. This reel needs some help really bad. A little bit of grease. I have this stuff called reel butter, and it works really well. I've had it for quite some time now. I don't sell it. I don't support the company for anything. I just used it. It works really well. It's yellow. Real butter stuff comes, it looks like actual butter, and it's a really nice lubricant for real gears and stuff like that. I'm not sure if it has a titanium base or something, but I have to go check and see if those cows are done being loaded and stuff. You know, you gotta work around the schedules of these people too. This is not my farm, not my ranch. I don't own this, so I'm at the mercy of whatever's happening here. And like you saw Sue last week, she comes out here, she actually, she's a massage therapist. So if you folks need to get a good massage, call Sue. You can get her on Facebook. She will heal any of the ills in your back and muscles and stuff. She's really an amazing massage therapist in terms of actual therapeutic results. I mean, people, you know, go for years to different chiropractors and stuff. And I've had back problems and Sue helped my back, so give her a shot. Sue Wesolowski, LMT, on Facebook. You can find her. Sue Wesolowski, LMT. I'll put her
name down. It was a great day outside with you. Thank you very much for coming fishing with me. You know, I know that I present this on a computer and the medium and stuff like that, and I'm bringing you the outdoors, but this gives you good pause for a moment to just take stock into what we're actually trying to protect, you know? Looking at a city, who the heck wants to protect that? This is what we're trying to protect out here. This just a basic grass. Just having grass under your feet is really nice. Connect back with nature, folks. It's really important. You know, do what you can to keep what you have safe and healthy, and you'll be happier in the end. Nature teaches us one really important lesson, and that's to take better care of things. And you learn a lot from nature. It's a really beautiful teacher. I want to thank you so much for all of the support you give the channel. If you haven't liked and subscribed and done all that stuff, it doesn't matter. I'm just glad that you're getting to watch this stuff. I'm not forcing you to participate in the web activities other than just you know, come fishing with me and hang out. If I had you here, I'd take you with me. But since you're not, I take you with me this way. And this has always been one of those cool things that the internet actually has a benefit for, is to show you some good stuff, you know, and maybe make the world a little bit more diverse and try to bring some new information to people and try to help them out on their fishing trips or their nature experience or whatever it is, just in life general. You know, we can use these tools for our advantage rather than using them for such negative results. So folks, have a great day. Thanks so much for the support in the channel. If you want to subscribe, I'd be happy to have you aboard the old ship here. And, you know, thanks for taking time out to enjoy this thing that I'm trying to present. It's, you know, it's unprecedented for me, and I'm just happy to be able to share it with you. Thanks. Have a good day, folks. Tight lines to you, too.